When we study the scriptures, the student of scriptures reads over the whole scriptures, the whole Bible, he'll see how important it was for God to have a people for his own. You see, this is one of the things God was after. You'll see that all through scripture. God wanted a people of his own, of righteous and fit people who were worthy. That's what God was after. And I'm not so much talking about the people themselves, but the more about the objective and the purpose of God. You'll see this all through the scriptures. And you'll see the devotion of God to this purpose, particularly in his son, you know, becomes the center and the focus of salvation. You see, God is dedicated to have a people after his name. Now, Jesus Christ gave himself for this. He gave everything he had. I'm talking about everything he had to see to the end of this, that God had to have a people of his own. And it read Revelation 21:3. We can read the final summary of this. We get to see the final outcome. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." Now, this is what God was at, and all down through the ages, we can read it. We got a record that God, and bringing this purpose about, he's never had any problem bringing men into this work. He'd never had any problem recruiting and bringing men into it. Men who were instrumental in advancing this cause of God and working in the kingdom. And actually we see that every one of the people that God used for this purpose, they were important to God. They were important to the work. Everyone was an active participant, an active player, so to speak. Each one benefited and moved it along. Each one was profitable and significant. It was by God's design. When the appointed time came for God to create a people for himself, to start it, well, God raised up Abraham, who would believe every word, everything that came out of the mouth of God. He latched onto it and believed it. And a man whom God could work and work in his descendants, you see, faithful men. God established a godly heritage of beginning with Abraham. See, now when the time came for this little family of believers, this little family's godly heritage to grow up, you see, there was Joseph. Joseph brought him in, you see. He brought him into Egypt. And when the time came to lead this nation out, these people, then we had Moses, you see. God brought Moses along. And on the account goes. God needed a human voice among the people. Well, he had his prophets to speak for him. You see, we had Samuel, Elijah, we got Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, anybody. When God called a man to be a prophet, then he spoke. In times of discipline and judgment and correction, well, God would use entire nations sometimes, you see, to come down and correct his people and bring to them the remembrance of God, you see. And when it was time for deliverance, when it's time to deliver these people, God had his deliverers, you see. He had Samson, and he had David, and Joshua, Gideon, and on. He had men who come in, and he delivered the people. Time to rebuild the wall, Nehemiah, okay? I need a king, Cyrus, to pay for it, you see. God never had any problem with all this. And matters pertaining to earthly things, you see, God used men to bring about his ongoing purpose on the earth. And he furthered along this way. And you know, men had to be involved in it, you see. Men had to take a hand to this thing and work with God on this because, you see, and it was justifiable and right because, you see, men who had to be redeemed, you see. So you can't stand on the sidelines. Not men. They got to be redeemed. They got to work in this thing. So that's why we appreciate it. And God always had a man on the earth to take care of matters on the earth as it concerned his progress and the preparation of his work. And now when something was needed from heaven, it wasn't here, well, then God would send something from heaven. Angelic being dispatched, brought something down to them. They didn't have it. So God always saw. And you know, God always knows what's going on the earth, you see. It's not just, he knows their hearts. He knows the thoughts and the intents of every man's heart. Just not a few, or those he was working with in particular I'm talking about. He knew their hearts and their too, but he knew all men's hearts. God knows all things. Nothing's hid from him. No thought. You don't have an idea or something that God don't know about. Nobody does. You see, even though the record depicts God as looking about the earth, God really don't have to look, you see. He already knows. You know, we got statements, his eyes running to and fro upon the earth. God beheld and saw. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower. You see, but God does not, he does not need to do this. He don't have to look and search after something. He don't have to come down and see or anything. God's not limited. We understand that. These are our limitations. God's speaking in regard to, God accommodates himself to us by speaking this way. And it just tells us of God's intent. God is, he wants to get him, he's showing you, I'm involved in this, you see. That's the way he's speaking. But God already knows. He told Jeremiah, go and speak all these words to the people, but they will not hearken unto thee, and you will call, but they will not answer. See, God already knew. We're the ones that don't know. God knows. And he tells Jeremiah one time, he says, tell the people, go and see. Go and see if you can find a man that would justify deliverance from the hand of judgment. I need a man who even cares about doing the right thing, who even cares about truth and justice. Jeremiah 5:1, run ye to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem and see now and know and seek in the broad places thereof and see if you can find a man. If there be any that execute judgment that seeketh the truth, and I will pardon it. Ezekiel, the prophet of God, speaking. And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none, you see. God's looking for a man, you see. I need one man. I need one man who can stand in the gap so that I would be able to spare judgment, but there is none. You know, it shouldn't have been this way, really. The people had no excuse. The nation, people of God, had no excuse for this condition. Not among the people of God. God said they were my people, called after my name, but they did not know me. Isaiah 5 depicts it pretty accurately. And he fenced it, and gathered out the stones thereof, and planted it with a choice vine, and built a tower in the midst of it, and also made a wine press therein. And he looked that it should bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. And then in the question follows, what could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked, it should bring forth grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. Who is this vineyard, incidentally? For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his pleasant plant. And he looked for judgment, behold oppression, for righteousness, but behold an outcry. You see, but God continues. He continues to look, emphasizing his looking, and all he finds is the failure and sin of men. For behold, for I beheld, and there was no man, even among them. There was no counselor that when I asked of them could answer a word, Isaiah 41:28. And I looked, and there was none to help. And I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore my own arm brought salvation unto me, and fury it upheld me. And he saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness it sustained him. Well, God was looking, brethren, to save and deliver. He needed a just cause to do this, to bless men. He needed to be able to do it the right way. God had raised up men who could temporarily stand in the gap and do this, but he had a priesthood, you remember, but it was corrupt. You see, and he had men who could govern the people, you know, and do a really good job at it, but they were plagued with failure and sin, but as far as a deliverance from this, our sin and our evil nature and wickedness, there God looked and he saw that there was no one. And there was no one among all the nations of men who could bring peace between God and men. The wrath that was to come, that consequently, inevitably would come. There was no man that could bring an end to this. Isaiah 63:5, God looked and he wondered. You see, I thought about this word. I often have wondered. Now, I'm going to do a little work on this. And if, you know the root word, for what it's worth to you, the root word of this wondered is stunned. Stunned. God was stunned. Another translation is pretty good, I thought. God was appalled at the... Perhaps speaking as a man, God was sickened by this condition. You see, look, and what an awful, helpless condition. He was like appalled by this and disgusted. Yeah. The depravity of the man was so dark and so great. And there was no one to intercede, to help. There was no one to pray or to uphold anything. So therefore, his strong arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness sustained him. Now, so we know that salvation, brethren, didn't come from any place on this earth. That's clear in the scriptures. God brought salvation down from out of heaven, and it's his righteousness that sustained him. Now, this is the closing that I have. The cause for redeeming man back to God was the right thing to do. Otherwise, God wouldn't have done it. You know, that's a thought. If it wasn't right to redeem men, God wouldn't have done this. He wouldn't have went in this direction. The work itself, the entire labor, was one of righteousness. God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, all together were working righteousness on the earth, bringing salvation to us. God said, I have called thee in righteousness. Jesus Christ is God's righteous servant. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquity. I'll raise up unto David a righteous branch. He will love righteousness, and righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins. So you see, this is the way that God was bringing salvation upon in a righteous way. Not by sheer strength and power of might, but by his invincible righteousness. That's how he brought salvation. And Jesus, the Apostle Paul said, Jesus Christ, the righteous. So we see that Jesus Christ is the one who brought the salvation. He's the only one could bring it as a man, because he was righteous and it was right for him to do it. This table that Jesus instituted for us, it's a righteous table. You see, it's the right thing. It's pure and holy and perfect. It's a righteous table. He had to have a righteous people to come and eat at this thing. You don't think that you could come to this table, anybody just can come up to this table and eat from it, you see, because you've got to be made holy and righteous to eat from this table, because the righteous one made this table. It's a righteous table. Amen. You see, the only thing that can separate you from benefiting from this table is to be like unclean. You see, so, you know, on the one hand, we're thankful, you see, that we've been given a table that's full of blessing and goodness and reminds us of the Lord. On the other hand, though, the exhortation is, like Paul said, make sure that you're righteous when you come, you see. Yes. So then, as we come to the table this morning, let's keep these things in our mind that Jesus Christ, the righteous one, he brought us a righteous table. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this provision that you've given us. Father, not only that you've given us salvation, brought us out of darkness, but you provided for us a way in to maintain our salvation, to keep us. Ask that you would bless us at this time. Protect our minds, Father, and help us to focus. In Christ's name we pray, amen.